If you've been feeling tempted by the Vision Pro but were put off by the price tag, chances are that you've been looking at this VR headset as an alternative. It's the Samsung Galaxy XR, a mixed reality headset running Google's Android XR operating system, and predictably, it's being touted as an Apple Vision Pro killer, as if the Vision Pro needed any help on that front. Now, there are a lot of similarities between these two headsets, but those similarities really are just skin deep. There's a lot more going on here than just the basic copycat design. When compared to the Vision Pro's Micro-OLED panels, the Galaxy XR houses two marginally higher resolution panels at 3552 by 3840 running at 90Hz. The device is also powered by Qualcomm Snapdragon XR2 Plus Gen 2 system on chip, which is essentially an overclocked variant of the XR2 Gen 2 we found in the MetaQuest 3. And Samsung didn't bother putting weird fake eyes on the front. Foregoing that odd lenticular display definitely reduced complexity and cost. But here's the big question, is it any more repairable than the competition? Stick around, you might be surprised by the answer. The external battery puck really sets the Galaxy XR and Vision Pro apart in the standalone VR category. Batteries are consumables and they wear out over time, so being able to switch those batteries out without digging through layers of hardware and glue is a huge win for consumers. Of course, Apple and Samsung probably didn't remove the battery pack from inside the device for the sake of repairability. The fact is, if you remove the battery pack from inside the device, it improves the center of gravity, making it more comfortable to wear over long periods of time. That brings the overall weight of the headset to 545 grams compared to the Vision Pro M5's roughly 750 grams, and those figures are excluding the roughly 300 gram battery puck these headsets use. Another great design choice is the magnetic face cushion and light seals, both parts that come into contact with the skin and will need to be washed and replaced regularly. The cushions on the back of the head strap aren't removable, which is a bit of a shame. It doesn't seem like it would have been an awful lot of effort to make these removable. But how do we get inside? CT helps us figure this out. Just like the Vision Pro, this headset's entry point is through the front and not the lens stack side of the device. The big tell is how the screws all face inward, suggesting the major components were installed from the opposite side. The plastic shell covering the sensors appears to be glued on, so I'm applying heat all around and using a thin metal flex tool and an opening pick to pry it away. Unfortunately, that does nothing for me. It seems like the plastic plate and clear shell can come away as a single piece, though the tolerances for getting a pry tool between the aluminium frame and the plate are pretty tight. We've made our way into the device, and what have we here? Naughty, naughty Samsung. It's actually illegal to use wording like this in devices sold in the US, so we reported the sticker to the FTC. But if you spot warranty void stickers in any of your devices, you can report it at reportfraud.ftc.gov. I'm going to go around and remove every screw I have access to. There are three press connectors under these gray plastic tabs that also need to be disconnected. That should release this plastic plate, except, nope, this is exactly why we don't like hidden screws. I forgot about the warranty void sticker and the single Phillips screw underneath it. Sure enough, that does release the plate. Once again, this is a pretty clever design choice. All the outward-facing sensors, that's the four outer cameras used for hand tracking and the two color pass-through cameras sitting above the bridge of the nose, including a LiDAR sensor in the middle, are all on a single modular layer, which means unlike the Quest Pro and Vision Pro, getting to the components underneath is that much easier. Let's move on. The main board is in sight and it seems very accessible. A few press connectors and three screws are all that's holding this relatively tiny board containing the Snapdragon XR2 Plus Gen 2 along with memory and storage. What's underneath is also interesting. I need to peel away the glued-on flex connectors to get my hands on the thermal layer. In most other devices I've seen, the thermals are layered on top of the SoC, not underneath, so it's interesting to see the dual fan vapor chamber combo sandwiched between the screen and the SoC. At this point, I finally have access to the screws to remove the headband from the aluminium frame of the headset, after which I'm going to go around and again remove every screw in sight across the plastic midframe. The two press connectors at the bottom here lead to the downward-facing hand-tracking cameras embedded in the aluminium frame. Once those are disconnected, I need to gently lift the board up and unclip the plastic attaching the fabric shroud to the optical stack. It's a bit fiddly, but doable without too much hassle. Once I've freed one clip from each eye, it's easy enough to do the rest from the lens side. Like most mid to high-end VR devices hitting the market recently, the Galaxy XR uses Pancake optics, which help condense the Z height of the optical stack. The early Quest devices, HTC Vive and PSVR 2, all use Fresnel lenses, which are based on old lighthouse technology. They're a bunch of prisms arranged in a dome reflecting refracted light. But that design requires space between the display and the lens. Pancake lenses, on the other hand, can be much closer to the display. They use a stack of curved lenses that sometimes allow light to pass through and other times reflect it back. As with anything, there are pros and cons to using each of these technologies. Pancake optics are harder to implement and require brighter, more expensive screens to account for their reduced light output. There are two eye tracking cameras inside each module, and each stack is individually controlled by its own motor for IPD adjustments. This optical stack housing Sony's 4K Micro-OLED panel running at 90Hz is the single most expensive component inside this VR headset. We don't yet know how much Samsung is paying Sony for each of these 4K panels, but supply chain sources estimate that Apple was paying roughly $350 per panel. These aren't exactly the same screens, but they're going to be very similar in price. So what do we make of this $1,800 XR headset? It's a tough one for sure because it's such a mixed bag in a relatively complex construction. On the one hand, we have an external battery that is very easy to replace when it wears out, and the engineering team decided to use Phillips screws throughout, which means specialized bit sets aren't needed to disassemble anything. The mainboard itself is very easy to remove and replace, and while it's difficult to reach, the panels on the optical stacks are easier to replace than any VR headset that I've seen. But the device falls short in other ways that we've seen time and time again in VR headsets. Despite the lessons from the Vision Pro, front-heavy design and crack-prone glass, for some reason Samsung decided that a plastic-wrapped glass front panel was a great idea to replicate. We'll see how well that holds up. The clipped-in front panel, the only way to safely get into the device, really wasn't designed to be removed at all either. And then there's that warranty void sticker, which really brings into focus the overall consumer-hostile design. As far as we know, Samsung has not released and has no intention to release manuals or spare parts for this device. We don't have a scorecard for headsets like these yet, but we'll score this device when we do. In the meantime, if you decide to buy a Galaxy XR, be sure you know what you're getting yourself into. It's an awful lot of money to spend on a device that is going to be tricky to find parts for and repair.